As the name suggests, mappings are an essential component of HIDD mapper configuration. HIDD mapper, by the way, is an adapter for USB input devices. Instead of plugging a mouse or a keyboard or a game controller directly into your computer, you plug it into HIDD mapper and you plug the HIDD mapper into your computer. Then you can configure HIDD mapper to translate some of the inputs it receives from the device to some other inputs. For example, you might make it so that when you press the left button on your mouse, your PC thinks you're pressing the right button. Or you might completely change the layout of your keyboard without having to do anything on the software side on your computer. And you don't have to stay within the same device type. You could make some of the keys on your keyboard control the mouse cursor, or you could turn a game controller into a macro pad. Let's see what it looks like in practice. This is the configuration interface for HIDD mapper. It's just a website you go to in your browser. You don't have to install any software on your computer. And after you set it up, the configuration is saved on the device itself, so you can connect it to another computer and it remembers everything. Okay. As you can see, it has many tabs, but for now, let's just focus on the mappings. To add a new mapping, you click here. To delete an existing mapping, you click the little X here. Each mapping has an input and an output. The way it works is that whenever HIDD mapper receives this input from whatever device is plugged into it, it translates it or maps it to this output and sends that to the computer it's plugged into. This is what it does at the most basic level. It's why it's called HIDD mapper. For example, if we wanted the left button on our mouse to work as the right button instead, we could make a mapping like this. Set the input to left button, set the output to right button. With this configuration, whenever we click the left mouse button, the computer will think we clicked the right button instead. You might ask, what happens if we click the right button with this configuration? The answer is it depends. If this option here is enabled, and it is enabled by default, unmapped inputs pass through, then the right button still works as the right button. All the keys and buttons and inputs that aren't explicitly mapped work normally if this option is enabled. If we disable this option, and if there's no explicit mapping with the right button as its input, then the right button will just do nothing. If we want to swap the left and right mouse buttons, we need to add a second mapping with the right button as its input and the left button as its output. Okay. If we have our keyboard plugged into an HIDD mapper, we can do the same thing to the keys on our keyboard. Let's say we want to try the Dvorak keyboard layout. We could, of course, do it in software, but then if we connected our keyboard to another computer, we would have to do it again. With HIDD mapper, we can do it in hardware. Let's see. This is the Dvorak layout, where a normal keyboard has Q, Dvorak has apostrophe and quotation mark, W is comma, E is period, R is P, and so on. Let's try to do this here. And you get the idea. We could do the whole keyboard this way. Now, as I said, we are not limited to mapping keyboard to keyboard or mouse to mouse. The nice thing about HIDD mapper is that it can change the device type as well. So, for example, if we wanted the right mouse button to work as the Enter key on the keyboard, all you have to do is add a mapping that has the right button as the input and the Enter key as the output. Or if we wanted the arrow keys on the keyboard to move the mouse cursor, we could configure it like this. Because we want the left, right and up, down arrows to move the cursor in opposite directions, we will set the scaling parameter to -1 on two of the mappings. If we want to make the cursor move faster or slower when we press the arrow keys, we can use the scaling parameter for that too. For example, if I set it to 2 instead of 1, it will move twice as fast. The scaling parameter can be used to alter inputs even without remapping them. For example, if I create a mapping with the input set to cursor X and the output set to cursor X as well, but change the scaling on this mapping to 0.5, the mouse cursor will now move slower in the horizontal direction. Typically, you'd also make a similar mapping for the vertical direction, but the beauty of it is that you don't have to. What if you wanted to invert the direction of the scroll wheel on your mouse? All you have to do is make a similar mapping with the input set to vertical scroll, the output set to vertical scroll as well, and the scaling parameter set to -1. Okay, these are the basics, but as you can see, there's a couple more things. There are the layers here, and the flags, sticky tap hold here. We have separate videos on those, so I'm just going to quickly say what they do, and for more details, check out the other videos. Layers are a way of having multiple sets of mappings for some inputs. For example, you might want your mouse to work normally most of the time, but when some button is held, you might want it to scroll documents. Or you might want some keys on your keyboard to have an additional function, because maybe your keyboard doesn't have the arrow keys or a numeric keypad. So you might configure it so that some of the keys you do have act as arrows when you temporarily activate a layer. If your keyboard has an Fn key, then you're already using something similar in principle, where some of the keys have dual meanings, like they may, for example, control the volume when you press them while holding the Fn key. The way you would configure this is you would make a mapping for that second function of the key. For example, let's say we want the WASD keys to work as the arrow keys. And you would only enable those mappings on layer 1. Then you would make another mapping for activating layer 1. Let's say we want the WASD keys to work as the arrow keys when caps lock is held. Then we would make a mapping with caps lock as the input and layer 1 as the output. Okay. What about these flags, sticky tap hold? Let's say we have a mapping that has the right button as the input and the left button as the output. Normally, this would just make the right button work as the left button. But if we enable the sticky flag, it makes it a toggle. It makes it so that when we press and release the right button, from the computer's point of view, the left button remains pressed until we click the right button again. On mice and trackballs, this behavior is called drag lock, and it is sometimes useful. Of course, it also works for other inputs. For example, remember when we had to hold caps lock to activate layer 1 to make the WASD keys work as the arrow keys? If we enabled the sticky flag on that mapping, pressing caps lock once would activate the layer, and it would remain active until we pressed caps lock again. We wouldn't have to hold it. Okay, what about tap and hold? These flags are a way to assign different functions to a key or a button, depending on whether it was pressed and released quickly or held for some time. This can be useful in certain situations. For example, we might make it so that the caps lock key works as the escape key when we just press and release it, but when we hold it, we could make it work as the control key. Again, we would just make two separate mappings. One with the tap flag enabled, and the other with the hold flag enabled. Okay. Check out the other videos for more information on these flags, and check out the project's GitHub repository for more information on HID Remapper in general. If you have any questions, please leave a comment. Thanks for watching.